Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to another edition of Camdy Candid Conversations. And we are at it again. And of course, I am excited again because I have an original member of the first all-female funk R&B band, Miss Cheryl Cooper herself. Thank you so much, Cheryl, for being here.
Thank you. I'm all nervous being on your show. You see, I got sweat going down my... I'm all nervous now.
I don't know why you're nervous. Just two girlfriends talking to each other. We're going to have a good time.
Oh, yeah.
And enjoy yourself. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. I appreciate you taking the time to have a little conversation with us.
Yeah.
We'll have some fans joining us, watching, listening. I want to tell everyone, please feel free to say hello to Cheryl in the comment section and ask all your questions, and I will be asking her the questions. She'll be answering for you. But just say hello. Let us know you're there, and let us know where you are from, where you're watching us from. I always like to see where people are tuning in at. So we're going to go ahead and get started.
Myself.
Yes. Okay. So they're coming in. I try to give them a few minutes. Also, for those that are watching us, at the top of the stream, there is a link that you can click on to allow StreamYard to show your name. Otherwise, I won't be able to see your name or who's leaving a comment. It'll just say Facebook user. So let us know you're there. I see there. We do have some folks watching, but go ahead and say hello to us so we know all is well. And we can get started. So Cheryl, I want you to just calm down. Be cool, calm, and collected with us, just like Connex. Let's go ahead and get started. Everybody's saying hello. Leander Palmer at Jacksonville, Florida. John Cunningham is saying hello. John is my birthday buddy. We have our birthdays on the same day.
All right. Okay, yeah. When's that?
October 6th.
All right. Oh, yes. We just asked that. All right.
We sure did. I still accept all wishes and gifts and all that good stuff. So
I don't blame you.
So sure, I always like to start at the beginning.
Okay.
So let's go back just a few years and tell us how this whole music thing started for you. When you start the instrument part and also just how it really the interest started way back when.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting. Ever since, I can remember as a kid, my parents would always give me a toy guitar for Christmas, every other Christmas. It just was something that was under the Christmas tree.
Hmm.
And, nobody in my family played any kind of musical instrument or anything. It was just one of those things. Oh, just throw something else under there. But expectation every other Christmas. So, bands had started being pretty regular on TV, you know, so it really interests me. You know, I mean, I had a toy guitar and mm-hmm. I saw people on TV playing guitar. So mm-hmm. I thought, oh, that's kind of cool. Well, it just so happens that, I had one of these toy guitars and I tuned it to something accidentally. And my sister, who was actually 16 years older than I am,
she was
married to a jazz musician by the name of Hubert Laws.
And I knew that name.
Yeah.
Yes.
Laws, from the Laws family. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So, like I said, this guitar, it was tuned in some little strange way. And it sounded familiar of a TV show that I was familiar with. And so I ran in, you know, to tell Hubert, the musician, and my sister, you know, hey, look what I can play on the guitar. You know, and it would like accidentally play to a theme song on TV called Secret Agent Man. And so once my sister heard it, she goes, hey, why don't we get Cheryl some guitar lessons?
So did you play that song? Did you actually?
It was just a matter of little open strings, and that's all I knew how to play. And the tune was just like it was on the TV. Yeah. So everybody thought that was great that I figured it out, you know.
You played by ear, yes.
You know, let's get her some professional lessons. So that's really how I started as far as playing guitar and, you know, music and, guitar lessons. And then, you know, as I went to school, I studied composition and arranging. Got my degree in music and all of that. So that's really the start of what happened as far as me playing guitar as a kid. Mm-hmm. Actually, I started playing when I was 11 years old.
Oh, wow. That's awesome. Now, and Cheryl, where are you from again?
Chicago, Illinois.
Okay, so you
were growing up. I've been in Los Angeles most of my life, but my roots are from Chicago. Yeah.
And at that tender age of 11, when you started, you were in Chicago at that time?
No, actually, we had just moved to Los Angeles.
So you were in LA.
Yeah, okay. We hadn't even been here a year yet. So, yeah, my parents had just, and the only reason why they moved was because my father was worked in construction. And so my uncle told him, why don't you move to California? You can work all year. Because, you know, in Chicago, he couldn't work in the winter months.
Right.
That's how we wound up in California.
Oh, okay. That's a good reason. The weather always.
Right.
So you started at 11. Now, I heard you mention that you studied music. That's what you went to college for. So you actually academically studied this as well.
Yes.
So during that time, high school, college, were you in any bands? What were you doing music wise, or were you just studying at that time?
Well, you know, it's interesting because I had such an interest in composition and arranging. My high school teacher, Mr. Howard Hoard, he really took an interest in teaching me everything about composition and music theory. I wound up, knowing enough to actually write music arrangements for the marching band for the football games. You know, I was writing like I would ask the class, what song did they want me to write off of the radio? And they'd name a song and then we'd play it for the next football game. You know,
oh, my goodness.
Yeah, I really took to it, really, you know, like a sponge in water. It was just so interesting to me. And again, because, you know, there was such an age gap between my sister and I, music was my only playmate. So, you know, I practiced guitar and I learned how to write music. And so, you know, all of it just kind of came together and prepared me for when I got to college. And I, you know, already knew the basics and the academics of music and writing music.
Okay. And you said something that I don't want to just skim over. You said you wrote the music for the marching band.
Yeah, you know, like they hear something on the radio. Mm-hmm. I don't know. So we'll say, I don't know, Ladies Night by Cool Again, you know. Mm-hmm. So I write it out for the marching band. And actually, you know, yes. The marching band, you only have, you know, like trombones, trumpets.
Yes, I know. I was in the marching band. That's why I can relate. That. How about Private Eyes? That's what we played. Private Eyes, Ripper Hall and Oates.
No, we played Peter Gunn.
Okay. So yes, and right now I do have a child that is in marching band. He's at practice right now. So that is really interesting to me that you're saying you wrote the music for the marching band. That's not a simple task.
but here's the thing, and that this is what has happened all through my life. I didn't know I couldn't do it, or I didn't know I shouldn't. So I went ahead and did it.
Now that's amazing. Well, I didn't want to skim over that because that is quite an accomplishment. And I can say that because I've been in a marching band and I have a child that's in a marching band. So I understand. That's why when you said that, I said, you did that? That's pretty good.
I had the big long sheet, the charts and everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the teacher really had enough confidence in me where he would let me actually, you know, conduct the band and tell them what to do and stuff like that. I mean, the football season is not a long time. So, I mean, I had a very short amount of time to be able to do this, you know, and I even was able to play in a community band in Compton, California at the time. And it was to play jazz music, you know, where we played, you know, where you sit down and play jazz, you know, not kind of up and dancing, you know. So, I mean, I had a lot of good mentors. You know, I the mentor I had for that jazz band was Troy Robinson, and he was, you know, he allowed me to write any kind of jazz chart or any kind of R&B chart using, you know, all the instruments of a jazz band, which is, you know, brass, woodwinds, and percussion. And then at that time we had guitar and bass. Yes. So I really had a chance to exercise those muscles, you know, doing composition and arranging, which set me up for being able to, you know, write the first song for Climax.
Right. And that's, you truly are gifted just by what you have told me so far. That's really something, accomplishments right there.
Thank you.
So we got through college.
Yeah.
So tell me what happened after college.
So, you know, after college, you know, because I had hung around, you know, Hubert and all the jazz musicians that he was around, like the Jazz Crusaders and Mongo Santa Maria, you know, they constantly told me things about, you know, if you don't know how to read, you're not going to eat. You know, if you this is how you try to get a music contract. You need to have a promo package. You need to have this. So they really taught me different things about the business, you know, things that I wouldn't have learned, you know, at school. So I had all this knowledge kind of setting in me as to how to, you know, my thought at the time was, you know, of course, I want to be a star. I want a record deal. I want to, you know, I wanted to keep going, keep going, keep going. And so, you know, I played with different bands around the city, you know, cover bands, as they call it, club bands and stuff like that. More than likely, I would always be the only girl. But that, you know, hey, I was determined. I didn't make me any difference. I was
There
playing
you
guitar. I was trying to play every song I
go. I love it.
could. I played in different local bands at the time, you know, for, you know, I don't know, maybe a good 5 years, I guess, you know,
Okay.
5 years out of college, yeah.
And then how did the introduction come to Climax? How did that connection come?
So, and actually playing with all those different bands, I was rehearsing with another band in the same rehearsal hall, same rehearsal building. And, you know, I was just, you know, playing, you know, in the band background stuff for another vocalist. And I saw these girls peeking in the window, you know, and I kept seeing one head and another head, you know, like they were taking turns watching me, you know. And just all of a sudden, they just busted in and said, "Hey, you don't want to play with this band. You want to play with our band. We have an all-female band called Climax." And, you know, I mean, I was already playing with, like, you know, pretty professional people, you know, and I'm looking at these girls coming in with all this energy, and I'm like, okay. And so, you know, at that time we didn't have cell phones. It's like, here's our number, you know, call us, we're gonna have rehearsal, blah, 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 blah. So I just didn't feel that they were at the level that I was, so I didn't call. I was like, no, I don't think so. You know, the idea of all girl band was cool and all, but it's like I had already been playing with professionals, so I
And
thought,
you didn't know because you hadn't heard them, right?
right. So, you know, the guilt got me.
Oh, that's funny.
The guilt got me, and I heard the little voice in my head said, "You know, you should have went to that rehearsal. You know, you should have called them." So I don't know. The next day, I think it was, I called them and I said, "Hey, you know, sorry I missed your rehearsal. When's the next one gonna happen?" So they said, "Oh, tomorrow." I was like, "Oh."
Thought you were gonna buy some time or something, yes. Or they weren't gonna answer.
So I said, "Okay, I'll be there." And so, you know, I mean, I live like in, you know, in the middle of LA, you know, and all the cities are around me, you know, Hollywood, Culver City, Beverly Hills, you know, the beach. I'm just like smack dab in the middle. So the direction I had to go, I tried to make myself lost.
Oh, that's funny. You
But you
just
know, everybody knows where Hollywood is. So I went to Hollywood and got to the rehearsal, and they were all excited and everything. And, you know, we started playing songs, and I was like, okay, there's going to be some work here. And I really, you know, from where I was like, I
good.
don't think I want to do this. You know, it's going to be a lot of work, you know. But
Yeah.
I was too, how do I put it? Not scared. I was too embarrassed to tell them I couldn't come back.
Really?
Yeah,
Okay.
you know, I mean, I didn't want to hurt their feelings. Like,
Didn't know
you
how.
know, we can't play, so I don't think I'm gonna. You know, I couldn't find the words to say it. You know, and I kept thinking, I really don't want to come back. But they were having so much fun. This was like the first band I had been in where they were like, "Oh, this is, you know, just playful and everything." So I was like, "Okay, I'll be at the next rehearsal." And I just kept beating myself up, going, "You know, you shouldn't have told them." But I kept coming back. We kept having fun. I would show them what I knew about music, like how to make the songs work, how to
Right.
put the songs together. So I really, you know, really used my talent to enhance the
Okay.
sound of the band, and they actually made me the musical director at the time.
Right.
So it was just interesting because, you know, we added a keyboard player, we added a vocalist, you know, which are the people that they see now,
Right.
and I just, you know, all those things that Hubert and all the jazz musicians told me what to do and about putting the music together and putting a band together and what I learned in high school. I
Right.
just used all that to make the sound come together.
And
And
it did, obviously. Yes. Yeah, yes. So I don't know what you heard when you went in there, but apparently it came together quite well. And we are all are very grateful because we love Climax.
thank
And
you.
That's really an interesting story. You were going to turn them down. You couldn't find it in your heart to do it, but there was a reason. Everything happens for a reason, obviously. That connection, you stayed with them and made history basically later on.
Yeah,
absolutely.
You don't know you're making history until it's after the fact, you know?
Right. You thought you were just helping some girls out because with the band at the moment.
Right. And then, you know, as we got the sound together, you know, I happened to be also working in a bank in the computer department. And I was telling my supervisor about this all-girl band. I'm in this all-girl band. And, you know, and she said, well, you know, if you give me a demo tape, I'll take it to my uncle. He's a producer for Peebo Bryson. His name is Johnny Pate. And he produced other people like Minnie Riperton, just a whole gamut of names, you know, well-known names at the time. Right. And so, you know, I want to say I was surprised, but in a way, deep in my soul, I was expecting it. So when she said that, it was like, oh, okay, you know, here's the next thing I'm supposed to do, you know?
Right.
But let me just step back just a little bit. You know, I mean, I just knew it was going to happen. So not in an egotistical way, but in an expectation way.
Okay.
So, you know, I put this demo tape together and we put a promo picture together and we gave it to him and he didn't like it.
Oh, okay. It's okay. Well, you know, just like you didn't like the band at first, right? So there you go. Okay.
But for all of your viewers and listeners, let me just say one thing. When one door closes, that does not mean another door won't open.
Amen to that. Yes.
So, you know, Johnny Pate, the producer guy, he just happened to be having lunch with an executive by the name of Margaret Dash, who worked at Solar Records. She was one of the executives who worked in publishing and Solar Records. And he said, yeah, you know, I got this demo tape of these all-girl band. I don't think they're that good. But maybe, you know, she's an all-girl band. Let me hear it. So she heard the tape. She loved it, called me to ask me when the next rehearsal was. And she came down to hear us, and it was all smiles. She loved what she saw.
Wonderful. What she heard.
And I'm telling you, within months, not even months, maybe 6 weeks later, we were signing a contract with Solar Records.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Just that fast. So you just never know. I always tell people, don't give up. Don't give up. Even if 99 people tell you no, that one person just has to say yes. That's all you need.
Thank you for saying that, because a lot of times I really want to make sure people who are aspiring to become artists or musicians or whatever they may be aspiring to be, I always ask, what advice would you give them? And I usually don't have to ask it because the conversation gives them the advice throughout the conversation. And that was really good to hear. Yeah. So when one door closes, God opens a window.
Oh, yeah.
Or something else for you.
Yeah, trap door or something.
Yeah, you said a trap door. Okay. So I'm going to just look and see. We got a lot of hellos over here. All the users' names aren't showing, but we have somebody from Memphis saying hello, from San Diego. Luther, who is the founder of the Fans of Unsung page, is saying hello to you. Yes. So, guys, go ahead and ask. If you have any questions, feel free to post them over here, and I'll be happy to ask Cheryl. But until we do, I have plenty of my own. So we're so glad that somebody listened. And I'm talking about Climax now, and enjoyed it and signed you all. But it wasn't an easy road.
No, and I've heard some other artists on Unsung, and I hear some of their challenges and the roads that they had to take. And I really have to say, Climax didn't experience even a tenth of some of the things I've heard on that show. You know, it was almost like fate, the universe, God, whatever your belief system, had a place for us to be. And it was like, you're here, and now you're here. I mean, I won't say it was easy, but there were steps for it to happen.
Yes.
You know, you have to be prepared. You have to be prepared. You have to be prepared. I can't stress that enough. And we were prepared for when that door of opportunity opened, we were able to walk right through it. Preparation is like, I don't know, 99.999%
Wow.
of the whole work involved to be ready when that door of opportunity opened. And we were ready. You know, You know, when we got to Solar and we signed the record deal and everything, I mean, it was like the next corporate year, or whatever, which was within a matter of months, we were in the studio doing our first album. And, you know, the record that actually got us the record deal that, you know, they said, hey, there's mm-hmm. something to this, was called Never Underestimate the Power of a Woman, which I wrote the music for. Mm-hmm. And that really set the tone for the theme and the idea of what Climax was about, you know.
Yes.
Bunch of pretty girls on the instruments and stuff, but you know, musicians that happen to be female that can really play their instruments and are serious about their music.
Right.
So that song really set the tone for us to continue on our, I don't want to say a platform, but just kind of,
yes,
our image, our idea of what we were stating, you know, out in the world. We were in the studio. We were recording with a couple of producers from Lakeside. We were their first project, Otis Stokes and Stephen Shockley.
Yes.
And, you know, they just showed us everything, what to do in the studio, how this goes, how that goes, you know, when you want to do this, when you want to do that. They really took us up under their wing to show us how things work in the studio.
Oh, wonderful. So was that... was that the first time for a lot of you to be in the studio?
Yeah, it was. You know, I mean, I had already had the experience of, you know, how a studio was because, you know, I hung out with, you know, the jazz musicians and stuff. So I knew what the studio atmosphere was. And even doing the demo tape, you know, we went to a small 8-track studio at the time, only 8 tracks. And, you know, I knew how to layer the track so they would make one sound. And I think, you know, I remember the reaction when the guy just kind of finally mixed everything together. It's like, wow, you know, they could really understand how a recording was supposed to happen. So we did get into the studio, you know, where there was at the time 24, 48 tracks. You know, they can see how the layering and how the EQing and the mixing and the harmonies all actually went in recording a song.
Okay, very good. Got a couple of questions. I'm going to go ahead and read. Dale Taylor is asking, why do you feel the Girls Will Be Girls album produced by Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis didn't fare well? He said it was a great album.
Yeah, well, okay, so Girls Will Be Girls, for a lot of people that don't know, was our second album. You have to realize that the idea of an all-female band playing music wasn't easily accepted by the buying public. Now, when our first and second album came out, Never Underestimate the Power of a Woman and Girls Will Be Girls, there was no video. So all they knew was there was some band with a misspelling of Climax. We heard through the grapevine that it might be a girls band, but we don't know.
They didn't see you yet. Yeah.
Right. And, you know, our album pictures didn't show us holding instruments. They just showed us, you know, posing or whatever we were doing. So, you know, I have to say the song Wild Girls, which is what Jimmy and Terry produced, was their first project, too. We were their first project, you know, their first outside project of the time. They had an opportunity to produce this all-girl band with, an idea of a sound that they had. And I just really think because the buying public, you know, people buy with their eyes, you know.
They buy what they see, yes.
You know, they couldn't see what this band looked like, even though, it was a great sounding album. I'm going to have to say my favorite album was Girls Will Be Girls. I mean, there was some great song structures, some great harmonies and everything on that album. I mean, for me, it's my favorite. The album was the album cover was my favorite. The songs were okay, I said that out loud.
Interesting. But
I really think that's why those two albums didn't fare as well as when all of a sudden the Meeting in the Ladies Room album came. And then at that time we had video because our first video was the Men on Pause. And so when they made a video of an all-girl band actually playing, performing and doing what, you know, they've always seen guys do, then it was readily accepted. That's when the success and the acceptance of Climax really happened. Not because the music was bad for either album, but because the buying public could finally say, oh, that's what I'm buying. You know, and now they're talking about the menopause when I walk into the room.
Oh, yeah. You got to work that. So would you say that, because did Solar Music not do a well PR for those first two, do you think? Because people didn't know that, or was it just, it just took a minute for people to catch on, or was it because they didn't push it from that perspective, from the perspective of an all-female band?
Well, you're almost right, because our Solar had a few different distributors. You know, Solar is just the label, the record company. And they had to have major distributors. Like when we first, our first album was distributed by RCA. Mm-hmm. The second album was distributed by Warner Electro Asylum. The third album, Meeting in the Ladies Room, was distributed by MCA. And MCA was like an all-girl band. You know, we really liked the idea. So they were really behind it. Okay. I mean, the entire staff of MCA was just magnificent in how they promoted the Meeting in the Ladies Room album.
So that made a significant difference.
Many people were
able to see you, and that made all the difference in the world, because the whole era of Climax came out, and you know, you all had a whole performance thing going on that, you know, it was more than just a song. The music was great, but the performance was great, and everything about what you all were doing, the whole image was phenomenal. So I think that had a lot to do with it. So,
oh, sure.
So we jumped from being in the studio to your second album. And then now we're talking about the hit album, all the hits and the songs that we know. I think this will be a good time to bring our DJ in, since we're talking about some music. And you know, we have the KMD mix going on. So let's go ahead and bring him in. And then we got a few more questions going on after that. So let's add DJ Doc. Hey, DJ Doc.
Hey, how you doing? What's going on? What's going on?
Great. How are you?
I'm all right. I'm all right. Glad to meet you. I love your group. I love Climax. I love the menopause. Me and Lily. I love it all. I love it all.
Before you start, I just want to say to all of the fans and the viewers and those listening, see if you can name these songs. We have a little trivia going on, and we're going to pick a winner later on. We'll announce it later, but we're going to pick some winners from this, and just overall, we got a couple of things we're going to give away. So we're going to let DJ Doc do his thing, and let's see if you can name these songs. And in the next couple of days, I'll come back and announce and post a winner on the Fans of Unsung page. You got to join the Fans of Unsung page if you haven't, because that's where we're going to post the winner. So if you're not a member, I know we have people watching on Cheryl's page. If you're not a member of the Fans of Unsung, please join, because you might win, and that's where we'll announce it. Okay, DJ Doc, you take it away. It's all you.
Hope y'all ready for this.
I'm ready.
Let's go. Here we go.
Rock Town Climax.
Hey.
Yeah, I know y'all know that right there. I know you know this song right here. I definitely know it.
You're so suspicious.
That's that Climax right there. Name that song. Y'all name that song.
They might have to dig deep.
Yeah, we got it all. We got it all. Name that song so you can win these prizes. I thought that song was about one thing, but I found out it was about something else.
Oh, I think we stumped some people.
Yeah.
And look at Cheryl. Cheryl's like, oh.
Time to slow it down.
You can talk, Cheryl.
I don't know how I knew that. This is my favorite right here.
Just my mind playing tricks on me.
That's all they get right there. That's all they get.
All right. Thank you, DJ Doc. Very good.
Climax. I love you. I love your music. Keep it going.
All right. Thank you so much, DJ Doc.
All right.
For sharing your time and talent with us, and we will see you at the next round.
It's always a pleasure, and I'm ready to go back in.
All right.
Have
a great night. Thanks.
You as well. Peace.
All right. Yay. So they, I see them naming them over here. So we'll come back and announce some winners later on. And people will also listen to this later and they can post it. So we'll see. So that was great. I love to do that little mix and see how much people know. Cause he threw some wrenches in folks. They were, I know some of them are baffled by a couple of those.
He got me on one. I was like, ooh, I haven't heard that in so long. Ooh,
yeah, that's funny. If he stumped you, girl. That means he's pretty good if you still.
Right. Yeah.
So we might have to give him a pass if you were about to miss one.
Yeah, that one. I was like, wait. Yeah.
He went way back, didn't he? Okay. Well, again, thanks, DJ Doc. So let's continue our conversation. We have the group together. You all got some hits. We see the videos. We're loving Climax. And then what happened? Something happened.
You know, sometimes, you know, when fame is just thrown at you so fast, you know, you have people from the outside, you know, kind of whispering in your ear, telling you, you know, how you can do and be better without, you know, so-and-so, without the rest of the group. You should be doing your own thing. And, you know, so we had people coming at us like that, you know, not that they were doing any one or two people, they were doing all of us, you know.
Wow.
And you know, I'm not going to say people have bad intentions, but sometimes as a viewer or a listener, you don't realize how it takes the whole to make the one sound as if it's just them. I hope that made sense.
Because, it does make sense.
You know, as a group, you know, we were able to make each other stand out. You know, the lead vocal or the keyboardist or the guitar player, you know, but it was a whole that supported so that the one could step out and do their, you know, featured presentation.
Right.
So when you have people kind of, you know, whispering in your ear and, you know, if you're caught up in the hype, you start believing it. You know, yeah, I can do better than that. I can do this on my own. And then, you know, not just with Climax, it's with all kinds of groups.
Yes.
Not just R&B, it's, you know, rock, pop, all kinds of groups. And so that's really what kind of happened. You know, people started thinking, okay, I could do this by myself and get all this applause by myself. Or, you know, if they're money motivated, they said, I can get all the money on my own, not realizing that it takes the whole to make the one sound like they're just one, you know, one unit.
Yeah.
So I really think that's kind of the girth of what happened.
Okay.
Now, how it manifested, of course, you know, you can go back and read everybody's different stories and stuff like that. But, and you know, just so happened at the time, I was always in charge of the prayer before going on stage. And I would always say, you know, just in case people started having these ideas, you know, together we stand and divided we will fall. You know, I kept reminding them kind of in a coded way that we really needed to stick together. But, you know, a lot of people, they feel that they want to shine on their own. And so, you know, different ones started doing their own solo projects or own productions with other bands and really started believing in their own worth. I don't even want to use the word worth, but their own ego in a sense that, you know, telling themselves, oh, I can do better than this. I can make more, you know, headway than this, or more fame or more money or whatever their motivation was. And really that's what started tearing things apart, because by the time we got to, you know, what we call the Pink and Black album, which is a self-entitled Climax album, the fourth album. I mean, we had done all the music together. We had done all the music together. And then, you know, people started going, okay, I have this song I'm going to produce. I'm going to do it over here and not tell the rest of the band. And okay. So those are the things that really kind of started pulling the foundation of the band apart.
Okay. Okay. And Luther actually has a question. Did you feel a sense of betrayal? And what would you say the biggest challenges are facing girl groups?
Oh, definitely as a betrayal. Yeah. I mean, again, like I said, I would always say together we stand, divided we fall. For, you know, not just a betrayal to me, but a betrayal to the musical family Climax.
Mm-hmm.
And what was the other part of the question? Oh, gosh.
What the biggest challenges, what do you think the biggest challenges are facing girl groups?
Oh, gosh. You know, even growing up, you know, society already pumps in our head to be competitive with each other, you know, mm-hmm. compete for the next boyfriend, compete for the cheerleading position, compete for the this, you know, compete. So they already have programmed girls to be in competition with each other. And because of that, it manifests in many different ways as we grow up in life. So with that being said, with that kind of being woven in our psyche, there was always this thing of, I want to shine, you know, I want to shine better than you. I'm not just Climax, but, you know, as women, you know, we have this thing of, we want to be in charge, or we want to make it sound better, look better, I can do it better. Mm-hmm. And it's just kind of interwoven in us, whether we acknowledge it or not. And that really is what kind of tears us apart, as opposed to really working together and being a stronger unit. Mm-hmm. We start to feel that we as an individual are the superwoman that can take over and make it better, whether it is better or not.
Right. And from what I hear you saying is basically the worldly views, or how the world gives stuff to us, and how we perceive things from a worldly view as we're growing up, how the media shows us, just all of those things combined, they affect our psyche as we grow. Yeah. And as adult, when we don't realize it and how it can affect in different ways.
We don't.
And in addition to that, it's all women. So there are usually some underlying things with that in itself.
Yeah, sure.
That's the reality of it.
Yeah.
Luther was saying the girls were not strong enough, meeting Climax, to stand alone in such an early development of the group. It was pretty early.
Yeah, it was. It really was. You know, I mean, I'm guesstimating at this point, but I'm going to say we had a good year and a half, 2 years strong,
mm-hmm.
you know, of the six of us being, you know, the unit that people recognize today, when it could have been much longer.
That wasn't a long time.
Not at all.
In fact, that was short-lived. I didn't realize how short it was till I was preparing for this and realized, man, that was quick.
Yeah,
you made a lasting impression in that short period of time,
right.
And did
right.
some major things and accomplished some major things in that short period of time. I wish it could have been a little longer myself.
Oh, you think I'm old? Yeah, I do too.
I mean, I'm saying that from the fans' perspective. I'm sure you all, you know, wish that as well.
Yeah. I really believed at the time that was what I was going to be doing for the rest of my life. Mm. I really did, you know? I mean, my whole life had built up to that point. I dreamed, I prayed, all of that. I worked up to that point to get to that success doorway, you know, mm-hmm. walk through the door of success and get there. And there I was. I was like, I finally arrived. This is where I'm supposed to be for the rest of my life. And I really believe that. I mean, I still believe that today.
Okay. Yeah. And we're going to talk about what's going on today in a little while, but you kind of touched on this, but I had a question of what artists inspired you as an artist?
Oh, you know, I always liked the bands. I definitely fell in love with funk music as soon as I heard it, you know, and I always say that the father or the grandfather of funk music was Sly and the Family Stone. I mean, mm-hmm. That music, the drums, the rhythm, the foundation, that really set me off to even my guitar playing style.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, funk music is my first love. So, you know, the bands that came along, like the Earth, Wind & Fire, the Commodores, you know, hey, even Lakeside. I mean, those were bands, and that's what really inspired me or really, you know, got me going to really. I've always wanted to be in a band. I've never been one to, I just want to be a solo artist on guitar. That's mm-hmm. never been my passion.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. And I don't hear a lot of people say that, but most of the artists I'm speaking to are vocalists, more vocalists than musicians. So that's really interesting because you sing and then you play as well. So you have a lot of musical influence from bands.
Yeah,
named some that I love. So understood. And when was your aha moment? When did you know that you made it? Like, was there a certain particular time, or when you heard your song on the radio, or did something happen that you said, ah,
yeah.
or did,
So, you know, I know a lot of people don't live in California, but for those who live in California, there's a street called La Cienega. It's like a fast moving street, but it's not a freeway.
Okay.
And you have to pay attention to the traffic or else there are going to be consequences.
Okay. Okay.
So it just so happened, there was a flyer on one of the poles and it was announcing a concert. And it's very beginning of, you know, our first album, the concert we were going to be on with, I think it was Evelyn Champagne King.
Okay.
So, you know, I'm driving down the street. I'm trying to pay attention to traffic. It kind of slows down. I look to my left and I see this big flyer, Climax. I'm like, oh my God.
On the street.
And, you know, to the point where I'm getting ready to run into the pole.
Oh, that's funny.
That's all I can see was Climax. Wow. So it was at that point, because, you know, all years before that, I had seen all these other bands with these posters and everything. So
right.
Finally, I see a name that I'm a part of, and I made it.
Oh, that's a good story. I love it. Just on the neighborhood street that you ride up and down all the time, you saw your name. That's a special feeling, I'm sure. Well, I'm so happy you had that moment and you saw your name on that flyer. Okay. Dale Taylor has another question. How do you feel about the music of today, and does it even compare to the music of the 70s and 80s? He said, I'm stuck in both eras. LOL. I'm with you, Dale.
Oh, gosh. You know, it's almost an unfair question for me because, you know, like I said, I grew up with great jazz musicians that, you know, you got to know how to read. If you want to eat, you got to know how to read. You got to know how to read music. Got to know how to read music. And, you know, I like the funk era of the 70s. Of course, I like the 80s because, you know, that's when Climax music was about and all of that. So for me, that's where my level of understanding is about music, as far as commercial music, as they call it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm there. I'm like you. I'm like you, Dale. I'm stuck there. I'm there, you know. And it's like I almost compare everything else to that. And that may be unfair because, you know, as each generation comes, they have their own idea about music. They have their own idea about talent. And they should be given the opportunity to blossom in their own time.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a funketeer. I raise my hand.
Yes. We all are, I think. Yes, absolutely.
I'll give you an E7 sharp 9 and give you a funk groove that you will make you get up and start dancing.
I should have had you bring your guitar to the interview. I didn't think about that. We should have had you.
It's right there. Right there.
Oh, we might have to do something here in a minute. I'm just saying. But, you know, there aren't a lot of bands anymore. I can't even think of a band.
Okay. Now, let me say that there's a lot of reasons for that. But let's go all the way back.
Okay. Okay.
To our good friend, Mr. Bill Clinton. Now, when he signed that bill to deregulate the music industry, a lot of things happened. You know, as we know of now, what record companies used to be then are no longer because of that bill signed in, I think, 96, 98, something like that. So things started to really fall apart as far as what we know of the music business then and now.
Okay.
Music in the schools started to get defunded. They started taking music out of the schools. I mean, think about it. You know, not to pigeonhole any race of people, but I have to say, you know, for Black people, sometimes that was the only place that you could learn how to play an instrument is at school.
Right.
You know, some parents couldn't afford private lessons. I mean, it's just what it is, you know. And maybe not Black parents, white parents, you know, Hispanic parents, whatever. But there's some parents, you know, they have to send their kids to public school. That's the only place that they're going to learn how to read, write, and arithmetic.
Yes.
That's the only place where they're going to learn how to learn how to play an instrument. So once you take that out of the schools, there's nowhere for them to go.
Mm.
So then we have a generation of kids who don't know how to play an instrument, don't know how to read for an instrument, don't know how to write for an instrument. And all of a sudden technology comes in and all you got to do is push a button. It's done. It's over with.
Oh, wow. You touched on some stuff right there. That's right, Luther. He said, take us to school, girl. That's right. That is so true. You went back there. That was very enlightening. Thank you for sharing that. You have so much knowledge.
Well, thank you. Hey, I've been in this a long time.
Yeah, but I thank you for sharing this with us. Those are some very good nuggets to take from this interview.
Yeah, a lot of people say, "Well, what happened? What happened?" But really, you know, you can't just look at the effect. You have to look at the cause.
The cause, yes. Yeah.
You know, if you have schools that don't have instruments or can't, I mean, I had a friend, but he's retired now, but he was a music teacher in one of the Los Angeles schools. And, you know, he would talk about that they would not put money into the music department to the point where he himself had to fix the instruments if they got broken. So you know, if the government or the, educational department, whatever people are willing to invest in their students learning how to write music, this is what we have today. They may not think music is important, you know, because it doesn't give you the kind of paycheck that, you know, working for the man does, but really music works on our psyche.
Yes.
If we don't have good music, you know, then it starts to affect our psyche. It starts to affect our society. Mm-hmm. And music is so important to us as a human race. Yes. And it's unfortunate that the people who make decisions are so naive to not understand that.
Wow. That's
powerful. I could have used another word than naive. That was politically correct, I said, right?
Yes, yeah. That sounded very nice. Yes, it did. But music affects everything. Music is a universal language. It could bring peace. It could make you feel love. It could make you feel happy, make you feel sad. You know, we have soundtracks of our lives that, you know, we remember things by music, by songs. So you're absolutely right. That's so true.
I even did a little piece about how, you know, the vibrations, you know, because music is vibrations. I mean, that's how you have high C, low C. It depends on the speed of the vibration. Mm-hmm. And there are certain, you can even look it up on YouTube. There are certain vibrational sounds that will affect you in certain ways. They have a vibration of peace, a vibration of love, a vibration. I mean, you can look it up on YouTube. They have a multitude of videos with just that frequency sound. If you want to work on your body, if you want to work on your mental state, if you want to work on your spiritual state, and really all those sounds in music that we hear on the radio, they do affect our psyche. There's no doubt about that.
Very.
It's proven, factual, scientific.
Yes. Wow. That's very true and interesting that you said that. So we only have a few minutes. I want to touch on a couple things before we have to go. That went fast, didn't it, Cheryl? See, you were nervous. You did fine. So I need to ask, because I know people listening and they're wondering, who owns the name Climax? What happened with that? Where are we?
Well, you know, actually, at one point, all six of us own the name. You know, I mean, there have been other things that have come up that has shown that, you know, that there was other contracts that stated that even, you know, fewer of us own it than what thinks own it, you know, but that's another chapter. But as of right now, you know, the understanding is the six of us, each one owns the name. So there could be six different Climax bands at this point.
And there are several at this point.
Yeah, I mean, as far as I know, there's three. I mean, the three of us have, you know, there's one original member in each version of it. And, you know, we can get up there and we can perform as Climax. The promoters hire us, you know, and some promoters have their favorites of who they want to hire. But, you know, a lot of people have told me, and I'll raise my hand, you can call it ego, whatever. You know, I've been told I have the better version. And you have to understand, I was the original music director to know how to make it have a presentation. I don't take anything away from the other girls because they did participate. They did contribute.
Yes.
And I get that. And everybody has a love and a passion for the music. But, you know, it's unfortunate that we couldn't be together as one unit to present to all of our fans what they're used to or what they are used to Climax looking like. I just love the music. I am passionate about the music. I'm passionate about what Climax stands for. And I'm going to continue to show up and perform the Climax legacy. As long as the audience shows up, I'm going to show up.
All right now. Very good. And hopefully we'll get back to that real soon. Before we touch on that, one last question or comment from Luther again. He says, now you're a pastor. When did you hear the voice of the Lord?
LOL. Okay. I know. Okay, you know, I actually, my title is now it's Elder Elect.
Okay, so I didn't know because I didn't. He said that's why I was reading the question.
Yeah, and I mean, it's not something I wave a flag about or anything like that. But you know, it's still vibrational. It's still spiritual. Music is spiritual. It really all ties together. You know, I'm very much into positive prayer and you know the positive vibrations of what the universe and God has for us as mankind. And that's really what I focus in on. So I just tie it together with that. When people want to come at me about religion, come on. People want to come at me about music, come on. Let's just make it all work.
I love it. Well, I thank you for telling us and sharing. I'm just reading the comments. I'm sorry. Luther, okay. Even Karen Briggs was devastated when learning that jazz was being taken out of the schools. Yeah, music is getting us through this time. Yes. So there's a lot of good comments. Yeah. So Cheryl, before we leave, tell us where we can follow you, find you, and what you have upcoming.
Okay. Well, you can always find me at climax.com. That's KLYMAXX.com. All of my social media is there. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter. We're on Instagram. It's usually Climax Music. You can find it that way. If you're not sure, just go to climax.com. We're getting ready to have a pay-per-view October 17th.
17th, Saturday, right?
Yeah, Saturday. It's going to be on, you know, again, that's on climax.com. It's going to be on Roku. It's going to be on Comcast. It's going to be on DirecTV. So, you know, just check out your guides and stuff. It's actually called Sisters of Power, a four-woman musical tour. So, again, it's on the website. Everything about me is on the website.
Very good. So we know where to find you on the website.
Yes, ma'am.
And Cheryl, before we leave, can you grab your guitar maybe and give us a little?
I can grab it, but it's not plugged up. Oh,
I'm sorry. I know I caught you off guard with that, but you mentioned it.
I know.
So, you could tease people just a little something if you want to.
I don't know if you can. Yes.
Well, we could just try it and see. I'm sorry, but I thought that would be. A nice little.
Can you hear it? Yeah. I don't know if you can hear it. Can you hear that?
Yes, we can hear it. You gotta play it, Cheryl. Thank you. I know that was last minute. We might have to get you to come on and do that. Oh, she's still playing, y'all.
Sound good. Yeah.
It's like once we get the musicians started, it's like handing the mic to somebody, a singer, you know. They're not going to stop. Oh, there she goes, y'all. Don't tease us. We got 3 minutes. What, you want to do something with that 3 minutes? We got 3 minutes.
Oh, man, let's see.
Hey. Oh, I love it. You go ahead, girl. You better play. I love it. I can't wait till we can get back to the live music where we can come see you in person.
We're really looking forward to it because we miss performing for our fans. We really do.
Yes, and I look forward to I want to see you live when all this passes. I will be there, especially if you come to Atlanta. You best believe. So Cheryl, thank you so very much for spending some time with us this evening. Everybody, please be sure and support Cheryl. Go to her page, like her page, keep up with her. Please like the Camdy group, and you can go to my YouTube page as well. If you didn't see all of this, it will be posted there along with all our other interviews with all our other great legends. So again, I thank you so much. Thank you all for joining us. Everyone have a wonderful evening, and we'll see you actually this Sunday. We have another Camdy Conversation with a New Artist Spotlight. So make sure you join us Sunday at 6 p.m. Eastern Time for the New Artist Spotlight, where we're going to showcase some new talent, independent artists. Thank you so much, Cheryl. Have a wonderful evening. God bless. And we will see you soon.
All right.
Good night, everybody.